In the first phase, the Soviet aim was to pinch out the German salients west of Leningrad and to the north and south of Moscow. Under remorseless pressure, the Germans were gradually driven back. But there was no decisive breakthrough, and in January, buoyed by his early successes, Stalin ordered a general offensive. Initially, the attacks made good ground. Soviet pincers closed around Demyansk and Vyazma, and threatening attacks were made towards Smolensk and Bryansk. But despite these early successes, the Soviet offensive soon ran out of steam. By March, the Germans had recovered, stabilized their lines, and secured the neck of the Vyazma pocket. Kharkov had been occupied in October 1941 and had already seen one Soviet counterattack. This had been carried out as part of Stalin's January offensive and had left the Russians holding a vulnerable salient on the west bank of the Donets. On May the 12th, the Russians opened their offensive with concentric attacks on either side of Kharkov. In both sectors, the attacking forces broke through, and a serious threat to the city began to emerge. In response, the Germans accelerated the preparations for their own offensive, launching it 5 days later. Attacking northwards, German armored formations spearheaded a drive into the neck of the salient, slicing adrift the entire Soviet left wing. In the planning of Barbarossa, Hitler had established clear objectives. The capture of Leningrad would secure the Baltic and connect Germany to her Finnish allies. Control of the Moscow region would ensure German dominance of the road and rail infrastructure and deprive the Red Army of its communication system. But it was in the south that the great economic prizes were to be won. The grain fields of the Ukraine would be the breadbasket of the new Reich. The mineral wealth of the Donbass and the oil fields of the Caucasus would provide the necessary resources and raw materials to wage war indefinitely. Spearheading the attack would be the 4th Panzer Army, supported by the 2nd Army and the 2nd Hungarian Army. These forces would advance from the region around Kursk towards Voronezh on the Upper Don. Once the Don had been reached, the infantry would dig in and consolidate the new front, while 4th Panzer would turn south and continue to advance downriver. In phase two of the offensive, set to take place 2 days later, the 6th Army, stationed near Kharkov, would attack eastwards, then swing parallel to 4th Panzer and advance down the corridor between the Don and the Donets. Phase 3 would take place a few days later, with the 1st Panzer Army striking east and south across the Donets towards the lower Don, flanked on its right by 17th Army and with the 8th Italian Army in reserve. These movements were expected to result in a series of encirclement operations in the Donets corridor, in the great bend of the River Don, and between the Don and the Volga. While these pockets were being liquidated, the left flank of the offensive would be anchored on the Volga, and the main thrust turned south towards the Caucasus. Stalin was convinced that the attack would be launched by German Army Group Center and that the overall objective would be Moscow. An obvious target was the huge salient projecting westwards between Demyansk and Vyazma. An attempt to pinch out this salient was regarded as being virtually inevitable. But this would most likely be undertaken in preparation for, or as part of, a wider offensive. Initially, Soviet planners expected the main thrust to be led by the 2nd Panzer Army stationed outside Oryol and directed northeast, through Tula, towards Moscow. However, information received by the Southwest and Bryansk fronts indicated an attack out of the Kursk region towards Voronezh and the Upper Don. The Soviet High Command believed this to be the spearhead of the main German summer offensive. The objective, they surmised, would be to unhinge the Southwest and Bryansk fronts and from Voronezh sweep north and east in a massive encirclement of the Moscow region. In the spring, Stalin had abandoned the system of theater commands, relying instead on the loose coordination of individual fronts, of which there were 8 facing the 3 German army groups in the east. The defense of Moscow was entrusted to 3 fronts, the Northwest, Kalinin, and Western fronts. Between them, these accounted for well over half the available frontline divisions in the Soviet order of battle. South of Moscow, facing Kursk and Oryol, the Bryansk and Southwest fronts accounted for a further 20% of Russian strength. But to guard against the threat from this sector, Stalin had deployed 2 tank armies, the 3rd and the 5th, between Voronezh and the capital. West of Voronezh, 2 belts of fortifications ran south and southeast for 150 miles. In the target sector, the southern and North Caucasus fronts were perilously weak, accounting for no more than 10% of frontline divisions. Though neglecting to reinforce this sector, Stalin had ordered fortifications to be constructed around Rostov, Stalingrad, and Saratov. In reserve, there were a further 10 armies. These were stationed well behind the front and concentrated around Voronezh and Moscow. Though still in the process of formation, many of these armies would play a central role in the battle to come. The first thrust of Plan Blue would be spearheaded by the 4th Panzer Army. This was stationed between Kursk and Oryol and was commanded by General Hermann Hoth. Hoth's task would be to launch the drive towards Voronezh and the Upper Don. Fourth Panzer consisted of 11 divisions, of which 3 were armoured and 2 mechanised. By reinforcing 4th Panzer with unmechanized infantry divisions, Hitler significantly increased its strength while compromising its speed and mobility. Supporting 4th Panzer was Army Group Weichs, a German-Hungarian force under the command of General Maximilian von Weichs. Weichs' army group consisted of his own 2nd Army, which he had commanded since 1940, and which now included 1 motorized infantry, 4 German and 2 Hungarian divisions, and the Hungarian 2nd Army with a further 4 Hungarian divisions. Facing these forces stood the Soviet Bryansk Front. This was commanded by General Filip Golikov and was by far the strongest of the three fronts. The Bryansk front consisted of four armies. Though numerically weak, they were comparatively fresh and well-equipped, and had recently been reinforced by the 5th Tank Army in response to fears of an attack in this sector. South of Kursk, the German 6th Army was assembling in the area between Kharkov and Belgorod. 6th Army was commanded by General Friedrich Paulus and had been massively reinforced in preparation for Blue. For the advance to the Middle Don, Paulus had 18 divisions, of which two were armored and one was mechanized. Most of these divisions were veteran formations and amongst the best in the German order of battle. Facing 6th Army was the Soviet Southwest Front. While this was still commanded by Marshal Timoshenko, it had not yet recovered from the disasters of the spring and offered him little prospect of an early return to favor. Although Timoshenko's front boasted five armies, they were all exhausted, weakened, and demoralized by their failure outside Kharkov. In the southern sector, the 1st Panzer Army was commanded by General Paul Ewald von Kleist. Spearheading the attack across the Donets and the Don towards the Caucasus, Kleist's Panzer Army had 16 divisions. Though like 4th Panzer, most of these were unmechanized infantry, and four of those Romanian. Supporting 1st Panzer, and commanded by General Richard Ruoff, was the 17th Army. Attacking in parallel to 1st Panzer, 17th Army consisted of a further 12 divisions, four of them Romanian, and again reflected the dispersal of armored and mechanized formations across the length of the front. The Italian 8th Army, with its six ill-equipped and unreliable divisions, comprised the reserve. The Soviet Southern Front was commanded by General Rodion Malinovsky and was charged with the defense of the Lower Donets and the Don. The Southern Front also consisted of five armies, but the front generally had suffered heavy losses in the battle for Kharkov and remained well below establishment in equipment and men. By now, both sides had reorganized their forces and reordered their priorities. The overwieldy German Army Group South had been replaced by two smaller army groups. Army Group A consisted of both Panzer Armies and the 17th Army, while Army Group B consisted of the 2nd Army, the 6th Army minus its Panzer Arm, the Hungarian 2nd Army, and the Italian 8th Army. This division of force signaled a strategic change of direction. Of the 16 armored and mechanized divisions in the field, Army Group A now had 15, leaving Army Group B not only virtually bereft of mobile forces, but with a dangerously high proportion of Axis satellite divisions. Moreover, it was Army Group B that had to hold the line of the Don, seize Stalingrad on the Volga, and bear the brunt of any Soviet counteroffensive, while the three predominantly German armies of Army Group A struck south into the Caucasus. Facing these, there were now four Soviet fronts. The Bryansk front, though shorn of its left wing, held the sector east of Oryol. east of Voronezh and holding the northern shoulder of the Don Bend, stood the Voronezh Front, created by Stalin while the battle for the city was at its fiercest, and reinforced with two armies from the reserve. In the bend itself, and standing directly in the path of German Army Group B, a new front was being formed. The Stalingrad Front comprised three reserve armies along with surviving elements of Timoshenko's Southwest Front. The Stalingrad Front was charged with the defense of the Don Bend and the approaches to the Volga. On the lower Don, and facing the full weight of Army Group A, the Southern Front was in the process of disengaging in preparation for a full-scale retreat. In early August, Stalin once again reorganized the command structure in the south. The Stalingrad Front was reduced from 6 to 4 armies, though two of these, the 38th and 28th, were reinforced from the armored reserve and redesignated as tank armies. The newly created Southeast Front also consisted of 4 armies. But while the Stalingrad Front ran for most of its length along the northern flank of 6th Army's offensive, the armies of the Southeast Front lay directly in the path, not only of 6th Army, but of the 4th Panzer Army. Towards the end of August, the Soviet armies of the Southeast Front were being pressed relentlessly from the south and west. Between the Don and the Volga, a huge salient was formed by the northerly thrust of the 4th Panzer Army and the continuing pressure of 6th Army's infantry. The Soviet left flank was held by the 57th and 51st Armies and was safely anchored along a line of saltwater lakes. But the 62nd, and to an even greater extent the 64th, held dangerously exposed positions in the salient. On August the 29th, 4th Panzer mounted a major offensive through the center of the salient towards Stalingrad. The attack sliced into the rear of the 64th Army, threatening it and part of the 62nd with encirclement. 6th Army was ordered to detach mobile forces from the Volga corridor and strike quickly south to join up with 4th Panzer's spearhead. But the corridor was only just holding and subject to increasingly frantic attacks by the 4th Tank Army. The pressure in the north tied up 6th Army's mobile formations for 3 vital days, enabling the Soviet forces in the salient to conduct a fighting retreat, escaping eastwards to inner defense lines west of the Volga. Once again, the Germans had failed to achieve a major encirclement, further prolonging the campaign and ensuring that the fight for the city would be long and hard. In preparation for the launch of the offensive, the Soviet fronts were once again reorganized. In place of the old Stalingrad Front, 2 new fronts were created, the Southwest and Don Fronts, while the Southeast Front was now renamed as the Stalingrad Front. The offensive was scheduled to be launched in 2 stages. In Stage 1, the Soviet armies of the Southwest Front would attack out of the Don bridgeheads, striking south and east through the Don Bend towards the town of Kalach. In Stage 2, timed for the following day, heavily reinforced formations deployed on the left wing of the Stalingrad Front would attack westwards towards the Don, with the overall aim of encircling the mass of the German forces investing Stalingrad. While the Soviet pincers sliced through the German rear, the armies of the Don Front, and even those on the tattered right wing of the Stalingrad Front, would maintain pressure in the center. Though ambitious, the plan was basically sound, capitalizing on the growing overextension of Axis forces in the Stalingrad sector. Most of the German 6th Army and all of the 4th Panzer Army were now concentrated between the Don and the Volga, leaving the flanks weakly held by four unreliable and understrength Axis satellite armies. Of these, it was upon the Romanian 3rd and 4th Armies that the main weight of the Soviet offensive would fall. At the end of November, Hitler created Army Group Don to hold a line between Army Groups A and B. Army Group Don was commanded by General Erich von Manstein and consisted of the 6th Army in the Stalingrad pocket, which now included the encircled elements of the 4th Panzer Army, the remnants of the 4th Romanian Army, and a reconstituted 4th Panzer Army, cobbled together from support units and bolstered by four weak panzer divisions. Manstein's plan was to attack through the Don-Volga Isthmus, where the Russian infantry was most exposed, enabling 6th Army to break out to the southwest. The plan had two flaws. The first was Hitler's opposition to any withdrawal from the Volga. The second was that, unbeknown to Manstein, the Soviets were preparing their own offensive. This would be mounted by the Voronezh and Southwest Fronts and would be launched against the Italian 8th Army on the right flank of Army Group B, with the aim of cutting off all the German forces south of the Don. The Don and Stalingrad fronts would meanwhile maintain the pressure on 6th Army in the Stalingrad pocket and repel any attempt at relief.